water in villages without wells, children getting a free education. That and much more is all happening through the New Life Evangelistic Center work in India. Be sure you stay tuned. I'm Larry Rice, and this is Here's Help. Imagine if you had to carry water for miles, just water that we take for granted. In communities in India, there's literally no water. The New Life Evangelistic Center is busy digging water wells, helping in those villages. My granddaughter, Ellie Rice, has just returned from India. She's the daughter of Chris and Martha Rice, who work with us here at the New Life Evangelistic Center. And Ellie, you were at the dedication of that well in that community. What thoughts went through your mind?
Wow, it was a great opportunity for me. I got to see so many people and meet so many people. I can't describe it.
Well, this was a new experience for you. 16 years old, found yourself in a country quite different from the United States, didn't you?
Yeah, it was completely different. I thought there would be more culture shock. Actually, I can't even describe it. It was so touching for me.
Okay, you went to the village, and they dedicated the well. It looked like this was just one of the greatest things that happened to these people, didn't it?
It did. They were so happy. Everyone was extremely happy, and there were some elderly women. They just kind of took my arm and started leading me toward the well, and was like holding on to me so much. They were so excited to meet all of us, and they were so happy.
Fresh water wells dug in India as a result of those of you that are donating to the work of the New Life Evangelistic Center. Let's go to that dedication ceremony of Papa Rao and Jeanette.
Today is a great day because God provided this time to dedicate this borewell to glorify His name. The native pastor, Brother Yesudasu, who is working here for many years now, and the in charge of the borewells, Pastor Vijay Ratnam Garu. So we are all here, and Brother Yesudasu is requesting for a borewell for many years now, and finally God provided this borewell so that these people, mainly this borewell was attached to the church. He is the pastor here. About 70-80 people are attending to the church. He is working for the Lord so honestly, with great commitment, because many people, they want to work in cities like in Kakinada and other places where all facilities are available. But in the remote villages, nobody is interested to go to share the word of God, because to work for the Lord in the villages, one must have so much of commitment.
Yes.
So that kind of commitment brother is having.
Mm-hmm.
And he requested for a borewell because you know the recent summer, how bad it is, and people suffered a lot at that time. This borewell was installed, and now it was dedicated to the glory of God through the hands, blessed hands of yours. And I praise Jesus, and I thank Reverend Larry Rice, and I thank all the people who are working with the New Life Evangelist Center in America, who make this project possible for this remote village. There are many villages in waiting list. We really want to help the villages with drinking water, because Jesus Christ is the living water.
Yes.
So that's why also we have written word of God. For God so loved the world, and He gave His only begotten Son.
Yes.
John 3:16.
Yes.
Because He loved the world. World means the people.
Yes.
So He loved us. So He provided this borewell. For that I am praising Jesus Christ.
Amen.
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 This is all part of the work of the New Life Evangelistic Center, digging water wells, teaching young people how to actually engage in technological skills for them, like women learning how to sew, giving away food, going out on the streets and street night feedings, free education for the new children at the New Life schools, and even going to the leprosy clinics. What did you think about when you went there and saw the school at the, among the children whose parents have leprosy?
The school. That was probably one of my favorite parts of the trip. I loved going there, and even in our free time we asked to go back to the orphanage several times and the schools. It's so, it makes you think so much about your own culture and how blessed we are in America, and how much more we could be doing about the in those situations and in those schools. And I mean, there's just so much we could be doing. And a lot of people don't realize the need in other countries and other places where they have nothing. They don't have the opportunities we do here in America and the education we do. And it's just so powerful and amazing seeing the work that Reverend Papa Rao is doing there, and the love he has for the children and the love that they showed towards us when we came there. They were so happy for having gone through so much that they go through on an everyday
basis. We have the regular New Life Public Schools where we have thousands of children at many schools. We have the orphanage. And then when you went to visit at the leper colony there, and then the special school that New Life set up, remember that, for the children whose parents have leprosy? Mm. Their parents had leprosy, and New Life has a school for them. What thoughts went through your mind?
I think just going to school and having, living your lives knowing that your families is going through that kind of thing, and going and getting an education and doing it, knowing you're doing it for your family and doing it.
This was quite an emotional experience for
it
you.
Was.
In fact, to the extent that you came back and you told your parents, I want to go back and spend a year in India when I get out of high school. Why did you come to that conclusion?
I know I'm going back. I want to do work there, and I want to work with the children especially. I've always felt very, very moved and connected with that kind of culture, you know, Southeast Asia, India, Nepal, and all of those countries. And there's so much that we could be doing, and they're so happy. A lot, the kids are so happy, and even though they've been going through so much, and they need so much more, and we need sponsors. We need sponsors now, and the sponsor program that New Life is doing right now, we could use a lot more sponsors. And I'm sponsoring two children. Once I just got a new job, and I've decided I'm going to sponsor two of the girls that I'm. And me, a 16-year-old, I mean, if someone in high school has the opportunity to be sponsoring kids, that means anybody could be doing that right now.
Quite a difference between that culture and this culture. The teenagers, for example, their big obsession is not who they're going to text next or what cell phone they're going to have or what kind of tennis shoes
providing
they got.
Providing for their family.
Yeah. It's so even in the midst of all their poverty, they still have a wealth of relationship with their families and the like. Did you learn from them?
Yes, I was so, that's another thing about India that I love and I want to go back to, is that you can have that separation from, in America, it's always face-to-phone texting, you know, talking to one another. In India, you're actually a community. You're actually caring for one another. And people who aren't in your family, they're still your family. And you're caring and working as a community, as a family, working to help one another. And you don't get that in America. Everything is so individualistic. And I want to be a part of something like that. I want to...
Amen. And you can be a part of something like that by partnering with the New Life Evangelistic Center. And as Ellie said, sponsoring a child, becoming a Club 24 member. It's only 80 cents a day, $24 a month. We talked earlier about the school, many schools New Life has over there, New Life Public Schools, for so many poor, needy children. But the one school among the children whose parents are in the orphanage. Well, we're going to go and hear from Papa Rao and Jeanette as they discuss that school.
The name of this school is Vimukti School. Vimukti means rehabilitation. So this school is mainly meant for to give education to the children of lepers.
Mm-hmm.
Because when, as you know, New Life has started free education program about 25 years ago,
mm-hmm,
in India.
Yes.
Presently we are running 15 schools in Kakinada. We have 7 schools, and in villages also we have schools. Hundreds of children are receiving free education because of New Life, I can say that.
Mm-hmm.
Without New Life, there is no education for all these children.
Mm-hmm.
Children born to lepers, they are facing great problem,
mm-hmm,
by the other children. That is why I have started a separate school for them. And in this particular school, there are about 700 or 750 children are receiving education.
Wow.
Apart from the children of lepers, we are also allowing the children from nearby backward class communities. There is a big slum here with about 20,000 population. Those children do not have a chance to go to school. There is no school here.
Right.
So that's why, with the help of New Life Evangelistic Center under the directorship of Reverend Larry Rice, we have started this school. And children are receiving education. We have 20 staff members here to work for to help these children. And we have classes from 9 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. And we have special classes also for the backward students. Children are learning about Jesus. Classes LKG, that is a lower kindergarten to 10th grade, we have classes here. We have qualified teachers here. Apart from regular education, the children are receiving computer related education and sewing of for grown girls. We are teaching sewing also. Now it is a summer vacation. So some children, about 250, 300 children came just to see you. Actually, our classes start from 12th of this month, June.
Encountering need on the other side of the world like this has a tremendous impact, particularly on the young folks. Mayori went with her mother, Jeanette, who you've been hearing from. She's 14 years of age. And what kind of impact did this have as you were there in India?
Well, seeing how they live and how they're with their families or the children who have been separated from their families, it's just kind of heartbreaking to see the pain that they have to go through. And what we have here in America and how close we are with our families, or the choice that we get to spend time with our family or not.
Do you think the average teenager has a clue as to life on the other end of the world as they get totally obsessed with their phones, their shoes, their stuff, what's so important in their world? Do you think they realize is that the world beyond that, a world that's much more than what is consuming them on a daily basis?
I don't think they do, because a lot of teenagers, they don't even watch like the news or pay attention to stuff that happens around the world or even on the other side of the country. So
this has broadened your experience.
Yes.
Ellie came back and said, I want to go back to India. I want to spend a year there. I want to learn the language. Are these some of the same feelings you had?
Yes. I wanted to start learning the language when I came back.
Did you really?
So that when I go back, I can know some of
Telugu?
Yeah.
So you wanted to learn some of that.
Yes.
Had you ever encountered anything like this?
No, I haven't been anywhere out of the country except for Barbados, where my stepdad's from.
So, but this was a totally different experience.
Yes.
Could you explain it? What impacted you the most?
I think when we went to this village and it was like nighttime, and we had rice and stew in the back of the Jeep where we feed the people, and they were in their lines at first so that they can get their food. But then after a while, they started just crowding around the Jeep and pushing children over and just trying to get their food so that they don't have to starve.
Just did all but a riot broke out?
Yeah.
I know that Papa Rao was talking some during that, and then suddenly he had to stop talking because he just had to get some order there, but he was doing some video work on that.
Yes, we had to find a light so that we can see, and because we've been burnt because people were pushing the Jeep or something, or pushing each other so that the food doesn't go into their bowl or plate where it goes on someone. And so it was kind of hard.
And the people were hungry, desperate.
Yes.
It was reaching the end of the day. A lot of them were afraid they would not have eaten that day.
Yes.
That's what is happening in the rest of the world. And these are individuals that New Life is trying to feed. We're trying to feed the hungry, shelter the homeless, not only throughout Mid-America, but around the world. And really try to help those who are hurting and those who are in need. The need is just really so great let's go to Papa Rouse. He started to share there before just chaos started breaking out.
Today, New Life Evangelist Center is feeding hundreds of homeless people. They are in lines. And our staff cooked a lot of food, rice and curry. And Sister Jenny from New Life and the girls, they participated in this feeding program for the homeless people. In Kakinada, Kakinada is about 500,000 people are living in Kakinada. Out of 500,000, hundreds of people are homeless. They are sleeping under the bridges, and they are sleeping beside the roads. And whenever there is monsoon rains, they are suffering a lot. Nobody is taking care of them. But I'm glad to say that New Life is there to help them with food, medical aid, and with the word of God. Tonight we are feeding about 300 to 400 people with rice and curry. I thank you so much, Reverend Larry Rice, for all the help and support you are sending to feed the homeless in India. Apart from many other programs like helping the people with the medical aid, giving education to the poor children, helping the poor widows, senior citizens, destitute pregnant women, and providing drinking water to the rural people, we are also helping the homeless actively. Almost every day, New Life is taking our help to the homeless. I thank you so much for all your help and compassion for the needy in India.
There's so much hunger, so much need, and the teams at the New Life Evangelistic Center are going with doctors and nurses in the rural areas. They're digging water wells. They have schools that have been set up, training programs set up, feeding programs set up, and even nighttime feeding among. We encountered so many widows when I went out that were sleeping outside, and other people outside. We went out to feed them. Did you do some of that?
Yes, I did. We traveled to, I think, like 4 different places, mm-hmm. and the last place we went, there were like a ton of homeless people there, and there was this whole little village of people who had put up tents or something so that they could sleep and be sheltered. And they, a lot of them came over to where we were and sat down, and we gave them plates with food and water on it so that they could eat.
And they used your plates on that occasion. A lot of them, though, times will use like these plant leaves. Did yes. you use some of that?
I didn't use them, but we saw people using them uh-huh. whenever they came to get the food from us.
So a lot of them brought their own plates like this.
Some did. Others, we just gave them the paper plates that we had.
Did you ever ask yourself, Lord, I could have been born in this country and could have been one of these children?
I thought what it would be like to uh-huh. be born there or live in a country like that, yes.
You thought of what it would be like?
Yes.
What thoughts went through your mind?
Thinking, would I know what the other world, other side of the world has and that we don't have, or what the other part of my country has that I don't have?
As I'm talking to you, your eyes are watering.
Yeah.
You feel some pain for these people. It's called compassion and love. When are we going to start grieving, loving, caring to the extent that we're willing to get involved in this way? And that's the opportunity that God offers all of us. 14 years of age, you've been blessed to be able to see this, experience this, haven't you?
Yes.
Changes your perspective on life. Oh, if only all the young people could see that. This is an opportunity God has given us, an opportunity that we have to work together to make a big difference for good. Let's go back, Jeanette and Papa Rob.
Feeding the homeless, caring for the homeless, giving shelter, food, medical aid mm-hmm. to the homeless is one of the main projects that New Life in India is has taken mm-hmm. care for many years now. Many people in Kakinada city, there are hundreds of homeless people are living. Mm-hmm. So without jobs, and it is like a cycle. Mm-hmm. So they born in the streets, so they grown up, they give birth again in the streets, so it's a cycle. Mm-hmm. So New Life Evangelist Center is trying to break up that cycle. That is our mission. Okay. So tonight we are feeding several homeless people mm-hmm. In the streets of Kakinada. I thank Reverend Larry Rice, and I thank those who are supporting this ministry, and I pray that God will bless them.
Feeding the hungry, sheltering the homeless, providing medical assistance, water wells, all the things that Jesus told us to do, the opportunities he gives us. And that's all we want to do through these programs is give you an opportunity. That's why we call the program Here's Help, to help you to plug in. to get a different perspective. And Ellie, by going to India, you've got a different perspective right now in life. How's your life changed?
I don't even function the same way anymore, I think. I mean, I work at a restaurant now. I work at Cafe Natasha's, and I just see like how much people are just leaving on their plates afterwards, and how much, like, it's incredible how we don't even think about it. We don't even think how much we're blessed in this country to live where we do and to grow up in the society that we do.
Feel like Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they waste?
Yes, exactly. It's just incredible, and I can't even, like...
After you came back and shared your experience with fellow teenagers, have some of them noticed a change in you?
Yes, I've changed a lot of the relationships I'm in right now, a lot with my friends and my family, and I think they've noticed a difference as well. It's life changing.
You told them I'm not the same person anymore.
I'm not. I don't know how I was living and thinking the way before.
You have a desire to serve Jesus and help those that are in need?
Yes.
Mayora was on earlier, and we saw the tears welled up in her eyes, and we see you, your tears coming in your heart. Think how God feels as He sees this day after day.
I don't know.
Think how the Holy Spirit is grieved when He sees that He's blessed American Christians to the extent there is so much waste, so much taken for granted. So many other issues other than the issues close to God's heart, which is His children. He's crying out, and He's blessed so many in this country. And yet, if we're totally indifferent to that, what are we going to say to Him on the last days? When He said, when I was hungry, did you feed me? Naked, did you clothe me? Sick or in prison, you visited me, a stranger, homeless, did you welcome me? What do we say to Him?
I don't know. I don't know how we respond to that.
Yes. That's why we've got to say, Lord, here I am. Work in me and through me. Lord, just help me, Lord, to use every day of my life for Your glory, for life is too short, Jesus, to do otherwise. And He told us to preach the gospel to the uttermost parts of the earth. You had opportunities to do that when you were there. Andrew, who was with you all, our stepfather, he shared. In each occasion, we not only feed, but we share with him the life-saving message of Jesus, didn't we?
Yeah. I love the church service too. you can see when we were in the villages and Mr. Carrington, mm-hmm. he was preaching to them in the villages. We would hand out food and then we would kind of, you know, have fellowship with them and talk to them. And Pastor Papara would translate, and it was so heartwarming seeing some of the women. I could tell that it was touching some of them and something new to them also.
Let's show you part of that.
I would one day be halfway around the world in a country like India. But because I kept my faith in Jesus Christ. I'm here today with an opportunity working with Pastor Paparo. Tell you the same story that my mother told me, which is that if you believe in Jesus Christ and you trust in Him for all your needs, He will provide. Sometimes we worry about our children. We worry about what is going to become of them when they get older. Sometimes we don't know, you know, how we're going to provide for them.
Back with two of our teenagers that have just returned from India. One of the things that impacted you ladies' lives is the orphanage, right?
Yes.
The school. What did you like about the orphanage?
The orphanage. In the schools, I loved all the kids and how welcoming they were and how much fun they had playing with us and teaching us games, or us teaching them games and showing them all the different games that we have here that are like hand games or where you sing the song.
Ellie, I heard you just wanted to keep going back every time you had a chance.
I did. It was my favorite part. I've always felt very connected with kids who are younger than me, and I enjoyed how the language barrier, it's never seemed to like make things difficult when you're playing and with younger kids and the culture is very different, but I felt like I only learned more from them.
One of the things that I don't think we really showed in any of our footage here was every time you'd pull up, or you'd come to a new town, or you'd arrive somewhere, they brought out all these flowers and put them around you?
Oh, yes.
Garlanded everywhere we go.
Yeah, everywhere we had. They gave us these big flowers, and then they'd throw petals at us or other flowers. And
would you feel like the Queen of England or something?
I felt very special.
I felt really special. Like, they loved us so much without even knowing that much
about us. You could feel their love.
I could, yeah. It was, again, I can't describe it.
It was totally different because people here, unless they're like your really close family, they're not as loving as that.
They don't talk to you. They don't look at you. If you're walking down the street in America, nobody's going to look at you or anything. Of course, they're going to look at us in India because we're foreigners.
Yeah.
But even you could tell that everyone's family. And I said that before, but there's a lot more community. And I felt close to each and every one of the kids.
Even the people on the roads that we didn't know, they'd pass by and they'd say hi or something, or ask us where we're from whenever we were walking.
Very outgoing.
Yes.
Very much so. So you love the culture.
Yes.
So much.
And the people filled with love. And you saw that there's something more than money to life. Is that right?
Yes.
I mean, we live in a very materialistic culture that a person's sense of self-worth and everything about it just revolves about money. Mm. It's not
it's
like
your
that.
Your status.
It's not like that over there, is it?
No,
it's not.
Money's not really a priority for them.
It's more of like surviving, actually.
There used to be the caste system and in all the different castes, all the way down to the untouchables. Many of the people that they met and worked with were among the untouchables. But we've seen the caste system go away in India as it's become more and more pronounced in America, where the rich keep getting richer, the poor keep getting poorer, the homeless are considered nuisance. They want them out of sight, out of mind. You've got more love, it seems like, in that community than you do, don't you?
Yes.
So, you ladies said you want to go back again.
Yes. I'm already starting to learn Telugu.
Are you?
Yeah,
so y'all going to be in touch, communicating, talking in Telugu next time we talk to you. Is that how it's going to be?
Yes.
Uh-huh. So tell us about some of the languages in India. There's a number of them, aren't there?
There are. I think one of the top languages is Hindi, and it's like more than 90% of even in places where the main language is Telugu, you speak Hindi as for like businesses because everybody in India speaks Hindi, you know, and there's different dialects and...
And then Telugu is one of them, and you all were in Kakinada, which is like southern India.
Yes.
And right there on the bay, Bengal?
Yes.
Right on the bay like that. And quick closing thoughts. What comes to your mind?
I think everyone who we see driving to the places where we're going, how on the bay you'd see people holding crabs like to sell them or something, or the people in the city who are riding bikes with a crate or a cart on the back carrying stuff to sell, or the people just on their bikes riding and how they are just, it's kind of different because they're weaving in and out of traffic and everything, but they don't seem scared about it.
So
they're just calm.
All part of their daily life. A few seconds, what comes to your mind?
I miss it so much.
that's you miss
all
India
I think
too?
About.
Yes.
Both of you do?
I want to go back.
I remember a lot of the times how I would spend my evenings after a really long day of going to programs and visiting. I would just sit out on the balcony at the hotel and just kind of reflect, and it's so much to take in.
Well, you can partner with us at the New Life Evangelistic Center by becoming a Club 24 member. It's only 80 cents a day, $24 a month. For further information on New Life and its work in India, go to www.newlifeevangelisticcenter.org. Please continue to keep New Life Evangelistic Center in your prayers.